Let's pray together. Our Father, we thank you because of what you are going to do. We're asking, O Lord, touch everyone and give us the grace to be doers of the word in Jesus' name. And we pray that all who are gathered with us to study today, you grant us illumination and inspiration. So that, Lord, you grant us the key of understanding. We'll study and apply the word to our lives in Jesus' name. And we pray that the study of the word will make us better believers in the kingdom of God. And those who are yet to know you, open their hearts, Lord, to your word, that your salvation, your grace, your redemption will come to everyone. Once again, Lord, we pray, lead us by your spirit and guide us into the truth. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
And everybody said,
Amen.
Thank you very much. In the epistle of Paul the Apostle to first to the Thessalonians, the first epistle, I'm reading to you from 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, from verse 1 all through to verse 5. It says, wherefore, when we could no longer forbear, we thought it good to be left at Athens alone, and sent Timotheus, meaning Timothy, our brother, and minister of God, and a fellow laborer in the gospel of Christ, to establish you and to comfort you concerning your faith, that no man should be moved by these afflictions. For yourselves know that we are appointed thereunto. For verily, when we were with you, we told you before that we should suffer tribulation, even as it came to pass, and ye know. Verse 5, for this cause, when I could no longer forbear, I sent you know your faith, lest by some means the tempter attempted you, and our labor be in vain. We're looking at the pastor's heart as we look at these verses of scripture. These Thessalonians have come to know the Lord in redeeming grace. The Lord had sent Timothy and Silas and Paul unto Thessalonians, and they preached the word, and many of them became believers. But as they became believers, trouble came because of persecution. We're looking at Acts chapter 17, reading from verse 1, from the very beginning, when these people accepted the Lord, received the gospel, were born again, were turned around, persecution arose. Look at it from Exodus 17, verse 1. Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and 3 Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus, whom I preach unto you, is Christ. He spoke to them about Jesus, Jesus Christ, who came to die for our sins, Jesus Christ, who came to take all our infirmities, all our iniquities, all our problems. He came to take everything away on the cross of Calvary. And the only way that will be done, that salvation will be ours, the only way that eternal life will be ours, and the only way that goodness of the Lord coming out of heaven through Calvary and through the cross of Christ will come unto us, is to turn away from sin and to repent of our sins, and then to call upon the Lord and believe that he died for us on the cross of Calvary, and then we're saved. And the Bible says that if you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, and that you believe he died in particular for you, rest of your justification, it says you will be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. And so he preached Jesus Christ to them, the only Savior, the only Redeemer, the only one that can take their sins away. And as they preached that, of them were told in verse 4, and some of them believed, and they consulted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks, and great multitude, and of the chief women, not a few. Many people came to know the Lord. Their lives were changed. Their lives were transformed. Those who were sinful before, the Lord forgave them and transformed their lives, and everything came anew. Because the Bible says, if any man be in Christ, tell me the rest, it's a new creature. Old things have passed away, old lifestyle passed away, old habits passed away, old sinful character passed away, and behold, all things have become new. That's exactly what happened to them. But immediately, the Jews that did not believe, they raised up persecution. They were not happy that these people left their sins, they left the gangs, they left all the evil ways of the past, and they came to know the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Look at verse 5. But the Jews which believed not moved with envy, and he took unto them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort, and gathered a company, and set all the city on an uproar, and assaulted the house of Jason, and sought to bring them out to the people. And that's the reason why the people then quickly sent Paul the apostle with Timothy and Silas and sent them out of Thessalonica, so that the trouble will not overtake them. But please remember, the Thessalonians were still left behind. That's their house, that's their place, that's their city. And they had nowhere to run to. But they were new converts. They now became believers. And it is out of this that Paul the apostle became concerned for them. Come back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. Verse 7, chapter 1. I'm reading from verse 1. Paul and Silas and Timotheus, unto the church of the Thessalonians, which is in God the Father and in the Lord Jesus Christ, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Write him back to them after they had been driven out because of the persecution. He wrote back to them. He said, what gives me joy, what gives me satisfaction, and what gives me pleasure is the fact that you remain in God and you remain in Christ. And because you remain in Christ, you remain in God, I'm so happy concerning you. Then he reminded them how they received the gospel and the kind of persecution and tribulation and trouble and the trauma that came upon them after they received the gospel. Look at verse 5, chapter 1. For our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost, and in much assurance, as ye know what manner of men we were among you for your sakes. And ye became followers of us, in verse 6, and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost. The affliction there is referring to the persecution that they experienced. Immediately they came to know the Lord. And since that time, Paul the apostle, he wanted to go back to them because he was concerned about them, like a mother is concerned over children, like a father is concerned over his own children. It's like a mother that has been taken away from these children, and he was anxious to know about the state and the security of his children, the Thessalonian believers. It's like a father that was just taken away from the ship where the people were sailing, and there was a stormy sea there, and then the father not concerned about those children, wanting to have reliable information concerning them. Are they protected? Are they provided for? That's the reason why he wanted to go to them once and again, but he was hindered. Look at chapter 2, verse 18. Wherefore we would have come unto you. We remember your predicament, your persecution. We remember the situation in which you find yourself, and we would have come back to you once and again, even I, Paul, but Satan hindered us. It's because of this that now Paul the apostle became concerned, and he said, we need to check up on these people. But the people were going to persecute, even almost kill, if they could. They were going to destroy the life and the ministry of Paul the apostle. And he said, what shall we do? I'm trying to go back to Thessalonica, and it's impossible. I'm trying to visit them again, it's impossible. I'm trying to strengthen them and comfort them and be with them, but it's impossible. What shall we do? Look at chapter 3, now verse 1. Wherefore, when we could no longer forbear with such each good to be left at Athens alone. And we said, we're going to do something. We're going to send a representative, a dependable representative, a trustworthy representative, a real competent, capable representative that will be able to do what Paul the apostle, what he would have done. Look at verse 5. It says, for this cause, when I could no longer forbear. Did you notice that in verse 1? when we could no longer forbear, that's verse 1, 9, verse 5 again, for this cause, when I could no longer forbear, that is, I kept waiting that the doors will open again. I kept waiting that the persecution will die down. I kept waiting that I'll be able to go back there again, and I've not been able to. And he said, now I am tired of waiting. I must get there. If I cannot get there, somebody else must get there to help the people. That's why he said in verse 5, for this cause, when I could no longer forbear, I sent to know your faith, lest by some means the tempter have tempted you and our neighbor be in vain. He wanted to know about just one thing, about their faith. In fact, as we look at this, chapter 3, it mentions your faith 5 times. Look at verse 2. What concerned him? Were they standing in the faith? Were they remaining in the faith? Were they defending the faith? Were they upholding the faith? Were they living by the faith of the Son of God who loved us and gave himself for us? Were they living by faith, not in the flesh? That's what he wanted to know. And that is why he sent Timothy unto them. Look at verse 2. So looking for those words, your faith. He says, and we sent Timotheus, our brother and minister of God, and our fellow laborer in the gospel of Christ, to establish you and to comfort you concerning what? Concerning your faith. Look at the next verse there. Look at verse 5. In verse 5 it says, for this cause, when I could no longer forbear, I sent to know your faith, lest some tempter have tempted you by some means, and then our neighbor be in vain. Look at verse 6 there. For now, when Timotheus came from you unto us, and he brought us good tidings of your faith and charity, the concern he had was that they still kept the saving faith, they still kept the sustaining faith, and they still kept the sanctifying faith, and they still kept the faith that will make them remain attached to the Lord and separated from the world. And he said, Timothy came back and he told us about your faith, and that alone, knowing that you're still standing, and you're standing by faith, you're remaining in the faith, that gave us the joy that our labor has not been in vain. Look at verse 7 there. Therefore, brethren, we were comforted over you in all our affliction and distress by your faith. That's the important thing he wanted to know about. Look at verse 10, night and day, praying exceedingly that we might see your face and we might perfect that which is lacking in your faith. 5 times in a single chapter. Paul the apostle thinking about the people, talking about the people, and then getting back to them. And then he's telling them, your faith is what's important. You came to the Lord by faith, and you're going to remain in the Lord by faith. The just shall live by faith. But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. And he wanted to find out, were they still standing? Were they still remaining? Were they sustained? And were they living by that faith of the Son of God? And when he found that their faith was still remaining steadfast, he was so happy. And then he wrote to them, that's what I said in chapter 1, look at chapter 1 verse 3, remembering without ceasing your work of faith. He said, now that Timothy came back and gave us information about your faith, and we remember the operation of faith in your life, and standing by faith in your life, he said, I remember that all the time, and I'm praying for you that that faith will continue. For our own understanding, why was he so concerned about the faith? And he mentioned that over and over, and he said, all I'm concerned about, I'm concerned about your faith. Why? Because look at this in the word of God, it is by faith that we are saved and justified. If anybody ever got saved, anybody ever got born again, it is by faith. In Romans chapter 3, Romans chapter 3, I'm reading there from verse 28. Romans chapter 3, verse 28. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. That's why he wanted to know, are they still justified? Are they still in the kingdom of God? Are they still born again? Are they still having that forgiveness and freedom from sin that I declared unto them? And he said, I'm happy that you're still keeping that, you are saved and justified by faith. Number 2, we're purified and sanctified by faith. That's why it's so important. You know, the Bible says, without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. That holiness, sanctification, purity comes by faith. And except they were standing in faith, they'll not be able to see the Lord of glory on the final day. That's why he said, I'm concerned about your faith. I sent Timothy to you and I want to find out, are you still standing? Look at Acts of the Apostles. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 15, verse 9. Sanctified by faith, purified by faith. Acts chapter 15, verse 9. And put no difference between us and them. Purifying their hearts by faith. If you find anybody that remains impure, it's because he doesn't have faith. If you find anybody that remains unholy, unrighteous, unsanctified, it's a lack of faith. And without faith, you know, the Bible says, without faith, we cannot please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Faith is indispensable. Faith is very important. If you are going to get sanctified, it is by faith. Acts chapter 26. And I'm reading from verse 18. Acts chapter 26, verse 18. To open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by what? By faith. Sanctified by faith. And if you have faith, you are going to delight in sanctification, you are going to rejoice in sanctification, and you are going to possess that sanctification to be a practical daily experience in your life. Not only that, number three, we're preserved and kept by faith. We start the race by faith, we continue by faith, we're preserved in the grace of God by faith. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 5. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 5, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. It says the way we're preserved, the way we're kept in the kingdom, so that we're not falling and rising, going out and coming in, we remain steady and steadfast in the kingdom of God is by faith. That's why Paul the Apostle said, all I'm concerned about, Thessalonians, all I want to watch over, Thessalonians, all I want Timothy to find out when he gets to you, I want him to find out about your faith, because it's by faith you are saved, it's by faith you are justified, it's by faith you are purified, it's by faith you are sanctified, and it is by faith you are kept, it's by faith you are preserved. Number four, we overcome Satan by faith. We overcome Satan by faith. When it comes with all his trials, all his trouble, all his wars, all his craftiness, we overcome all those craftiness and wars of the enemy by faith. Ephesians chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 16. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 16. Above all, taking the shield of faith, whereby, wherewith we shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, that is, of the devil, of Satan. That means then if the people did not have faith, all those idolaters in Thessalonica would have been able to overcome them. All those occultic people in Thessalonica, they would have been able to overcome them. Don't you remember that Thessalonica was filled with idolatry? In fact, it says, you turn to God from idols, dead idols. And the other people that still remained unconverted, they were idolatrous people, occultic people. And it is by this faith that these Thessalonian believers were able to overcome. And if you're living in any community where there's idolatry, where there's occultism, all you need is faith. And then you'll be able to stand by faith. That's why Paul the Apostle was checking up, how about your faith? And that's why we need to be checking up from you, how about your faith? The faith through which we're saved, the faith through which we're sanctified, and the faith through which we're preserved and kept, and the faith through which we conquer Satan. Not only that, we even conquer the world by that faith. 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. And I'm reading from verse 3 and from verse 4. 1 John chapter 5, verse 3, verse 4. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. That's verse 3. And his commandments are not grievous. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world. Even what? Even our faith. in all those things, pollutions of the world, the pornography of the world, and all these perversions of the world, if you're going to be able to overcome, because the world is all around you in your community, all around you in the place where you live, and you hear the noise, and you hear all the evils, and they're pumping out that dirty sin every time. If it's not going to splash on you and remain on you, and you're going to overcome every pollution, perversion coming from the world, you're going to be able to maintain your faith. And there's so much perversion in Thessalonica, and there's so much pollution in the society. And Paul, the apostle, wanted to know, were they overcoming? Overcoming Satan, overcoming temptation, overcoming the tempter, overcoming the world, overcoming all those things. Go and check on Timothy about their faith. And if the faith is so important, you should be checking up to you about your own faith. Are you checking up? That are you overcoming daily by the faith of the Son of God? Are you living daily in victory, victory over sin, victory over evil, by the faith that has been planted in you when you are born again? As Paul the Apostle told Timothy to check up on their faith, you should be checking up to you on your faith. It's by faith that we stand. Winds will blow and darts will be thrown at us, but it is by that faith we keep standing every time. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 24. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. I read there from verse 24, standing by faith. It says in verse 24, not for that we have dominion over your faith, but are helpers of your joy. For by faith we stand. By faith, we stand. The devil would like to push you down. Persecutors would like to push you down. Detractors would like to trample over you. And the world would like to drag you down. But it's by faith that we stand. And all those things were beating against the Christian lives of the Thessalonians. And Paul the apostle knew that if they were going to stand, there was only one way they were going to stand. And he said, Timothy, go and check up about their faith. And then it's by that faith we walk by faith. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 7. For we walk by faith and not by sight. We walk by faith as we walk in the law of God, in the way of, in this narrow path, narrow way that leads to heaven. The only way we can walk straight, in that straight and narrow way, is to have faith, faith in the Lord, that we know that now we're saved by faith, and that faith is sustained and is keeping us alive in the Lord. Walking by faith, we live by faith. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. In Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. You always remember that they said, the Lord bore all my sins, all my trauma, all my trouble, all my sorrow, everything evil. The devil wanted to stop my journey, but Jesus Christ paid it all. And he rejoiced in that and believed in that every day. And now he says, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. And I wanted to check up whether the Thessalonians were having the same victory as he was having. In fact, any of the promises of God that the Lord gives us, promise for salvation, promise for sanctification, promise for healing, promise for deliverance, promise for riches, promise for wealth, promise for being stable in the Lord, and promise of having all the good things of life, and promise that everything concerning you, concerning us, will be perfected, and promise that we'll get to heaven. All those promises we inherit by faith. The promises are there, and you are there. And there's a promise to match every problem of your life. And whatever the mountain, whatever the storm, and whatever the heartache, and whatever the headache in your life, the promise of God is there to match every problem. And if you're going to overcome every problem, it is by faith. We inherit the promises by faith. That's why Paul the apostle was concerned. And the apostle was saying, all the provisions are yours, all the promises are yours, all the preservation for protection, everything is yours. But there's one thing I want Timothy to check up when he gets to you. Because without the arms of faith, and without the faith to be able to get all those things, you'll not be able to get them. We inherit the promises of God by faith. Timothy, go and check up. How about their faith? We're looking at Hebrews chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 12. Hebrews chapter 6, we're reading from verse 12. It says that Ye be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Through faith and patience inherit the promises. Faith is indispensable in pleasing God, and faith is indispensable in living for Christ. Faith is indispensable in living with Him in all eternity. That's why Paul was so anxious to know that these believers were still keeping the faith and were standing to the test. And the same thing with you. As those people stood, you will stand in Jesus' name. We're not going to look at the study in detail. I'm going to divide the study to three parts. Number one, the purposeful follow-up by a tender, prayerful soul winner. Purposeful follow-up. Now you understand, I read it to you already, that in Acts of the Apostles chapter 17, Paul the Apostle with Timothy and Silas, that is Silvanus, they have gone to Thessalonica. And he preached the word unto them, and many of them believed, and they gave their lives to the Lord Jesus Christ. And after that, persecution arose. Now there was follow-up. That's why after we've done all this evangelism that we're doing, after we contacted people and we knocked on doors, we preached the gospel to many people, and they said they came to the Lord, we need to follow up on them, integrate them with the church, so that they'll continue to grow in their newfound faith and the joy of salvation that came unto them. That's why you have point number one, purposeful follow up by tender prayer for soul winning. Number two, persecuted fellowship of teachable purified saints. That is, these people, they were teachable. Thank God they received the teaching. Their hearts were soft and softy. And everything the Lord was teaching them through the Apostle Paul, they accepted everything and were purified too. But persecution came upon their fellowship. And Paul, the apostle, wanted to encourage them and say, don't mind the persecution. I told you before that whosoever, everyone that will live godly will suffer persecution. Therefore, don't allow that to discourage you. Continue. And then number three, paternal feeling, parental feeling, pastoral feeling for tempted, persecuted sons. We're looking at number one. Let's come back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, I'm reading from verses 1 and 2. Wherefore, when we could no longer forbear, we thought it good to be left at Athens alone. You know what Paul the apostle is saying here? He's saying, Paul, Silas, Timothy, they were together. And they loved one another. And they were ministering together. And then they came to Athens. And Athens was a Greek city. And in Athens, that's the place where Paul the apostle said, I beheld and saw your altars that you say to the unknown God. It was a place of trouble, a dangerous place, a place of insecurity. And actually, Paul the apostle needed Silas to be with him. He needed Timothy to be with him. It wasn't a place they should stay alone. But all the time they were together in Athens, he was saying that these Thessalonians were not hearing about them. And there was no postage possibility then. There was no radio then. There was no telephone then. And there was no way they could contact them. And he said, somebody must have to go. And he was saying, but Paul, if we, any of us, will leave, you'll be alone here. There'll be nobody with you. And the security here is very doubtful. How are we going to leave you here because of the situation here? Look at that in Acts of the Apostles chapter 17. Acts of the Apostles chapter 17, and then you will see what Paul the apostle was talking about, the insecurity that was there and the problem that was there. And he said, I'm sending this Timothy, even though I'll be left alone in this insecure place. That's how much he loved them. That's how much you ought to love the newcomers. That's how much you ought to love the people that have just come to know the Lord. That even if he places you in a position, situation of insecurity, you'll still be able to reach out unto those newcomers and bring them to the fellowship of the people of God. Acts of the Apostles chapter 17 verse 15. They that conducted Paul brought him unto Athens, and receiving a commandment unto Silas and Timotheus for to come to him with all speed, they departed. But now while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. You understand that Athens was a place of idolatry, of occultism, of a real, terrible, dangerous, satanic activities. Therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons, and in the market daily with them that met with him. Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him, and some said, what will this babbler say? That's how they looked at him in Athens. He was a barbarian. He was a babbler. He was a person that didn't know what he was doing. Can you imagine in such a place where there was no security, in such a place where he needed all the companionship of Silas and Timothy? He still said, I'm interested in Thessalonica. These Thessalonians, I don't know whether they're still keeping the faith or not. My own physical security, don't mention that. My own physical protection, don't mind all that. All I'm concerned about is the protection and the preservation and the faith of these Thessalonians. And then when he was left alone, they said, he's a babbler. They said, what will this babbler say? Other some, he seemed to be a setter forth of strange gods. They were even talking about him as if he is an idol worshiper himself, because he's talking about something they need to understand. He preached unto them Jesus and the resurrection. Look at verse 19. And they took him and they brought him unto Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is, for thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know, therefore, what these things mean. For all the Athenians and the strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious. That's the situation in which he was left alone. He sent Timothy, I need you here. I know that your companionship, your fellowship is very important to me here, because all these people around me, they are dangerous people, idolatrous people, superstitious people, occultic people. But I'd rather be left alone in danger and insecurity rather than leave those Thessalonians to allow their faith to be wasted. And let's look at verse 23. It says, for as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, he said, him declare I unto you. Let's come back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 1. Now you understand the love he had for them, that he'd rather be in danger, rather give up his liberty, his protection, his security, than to leave those Thessalonians in danger of losing their faith. Chapter 3, verse 1, 1 Thessalonians, wherefore, when we could no longer forbear, we thought it good to be left at Athens alone, and sent Timotheus, our brother and minister of God, a fellow laborer in the gospel of Christ, to establish you and to comfort you concerning your faith. He said, I'm concerned about you. And now, who did he send? He sent this young minister, this young man, this young companion, and he sent this Timothy. What do we know about Timothy? Look at that verse 2. It says, Timothy, number one, our brother. That means he was really born again. Paul the apostle didn't have any doubt at all that this man was born again. If you're going to send somebody to go and follow up, make sure they are born again. You want to send him on a missionary trip, make sure he's born again. You want to send him to go and encourage other people, lift up other people, strengthen other people, comfort other people. You want to send him to go and establish a new church of new converts. Number one, must make sure that the person is like Timothy, that he is our brother, he is born again. Number two, and minister of God. This man, Timothy, was a minister of God. He knew the Lord and he had the call of God upon his life and was going to minister the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then our fellow laborer in the gospel of Christ. That then informs us the kind of people that you're going to make to pastor a new church or to lead a new house fellowship, or to be able to be a zonal leader in a new zone, or to be able to help us in any new satellite church. We don't just pick anybody and say, well, we need somebody there in that satellite church. Go and do that for us. Or maybe there's vacancy in any country, in Africa or beyond Africa, and they say, send us a missionary, send us a missionary. We don't just pick somebody, somebody here who is not dependable, who is not trustworthy, who we don't even know about his life, but somebody who has been a worker already, a preacher already, a pastor already, a fervent person already, a prayerful person already, a dependable, trustworthy person already, like Timothy, because we are told, a fellow laborer in the gospel of Christ, and then is to establish you and to comfort you concerning your faith. We know something more about this Timothy. Look at Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. We're thinking about the people were sent out. You know, some people, they say, you know, you're too useful over here at the headquarters. We cannot send you out. That's wrong. That's wrong. Paul, the apostle, needed Timothy to be with him in Athens. And, you know, there are some people that to think that, you know, the GS needs all these great ministers, wonderful ministers, dependable ministers, because how can he carry the load alone? You are right. How can I carry it alone? It, for his security, for his protection, for his preservation, and for health, he needs all these other people. Even those other people, it is like they are perishing. Why don't you just allow them to perish if they are going to perish? But you need all these people here around you. The Bible says no. The Spirit of God says no. Paul the Apostle says no. That we will rather remain short-staffed at the headquarters over here where we are. We'll rather be exposed to all the kind of insecurity in Athens rather than leave Thessalonica without a pastor, or leave that new country, new fellowship, a new church without a pastor. That's why Paul the Apostle said, I'm going to find somebody capable, somebody competent, somebody committed, somebody commissioned. I'm going to send such a person unto them. Look at Philippians chapter 2. I'm reading there from verse 19. Philippians chapter 2, verse 19. It says, but I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timotheus shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. Anytime Paul the Apostle wanted to know the state of the people, the situation of the people, the standing of the people, he finds a person like Timothy, dependable, trustworthy, and really spiritual. He says in verse 20, for I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state, for all seek their own. He says all the other people are not sanctified, they are selfish. All the other people are not sanctified, they are self-centered. All the other people are not dependable because they only think about themselves. He said, they only seek their own, not the things which belong to Jesus Christ. But you know him, Timothy, the proof of him, that as a son with the father, he has served with me in the gospel. Verse 23, him, Timothy, therefore, I hope to send presently, so soon as I shall see how it will go with me. That's Timothy. I pray you will be like that. I said you will be like that. And this Timothy was a person that, you know, Paul the Apostle wrote to later. And see what he wrote to him in 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 2. And the things which thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. He said, Timothy, I'm sending you out. You know what you're going to do? The same way I trained you, and the same way I developed you, and the same way I poured my life, my resources into you, and now you're spiritual, and you know the doctrine, you know the teaching, you know the lifestyle, you know the way you ought to live. The same thing, you are going to find faithful men who shall be able to teach others also, and you are going to pass that on to them. You're going to train other people to do what you have been trained to do. 2 Timothy chapter 4 verse 5. Chapter 4 verse 5, watch thou in all things. Said Timothy, watch in all things, endure affliction, do the work of an evangelist. He said, as you go there, yes, we thank God that some of them are converted already. There'll be those who are not born again. Any country you are sent to, there are unbelievers there too. Any fellowship you are sent to, there will be unbelievers there too. Any house fellowship you are sent to, there might be unbelievers there too. And any new satellite church you are sent to, there will be believers like Thessalonians. There will be unbelievers there too. Therefore, you'll do the work of an evangelist, of a soul winner. You'll preach the gospel so that those who are not saved in that fellowship, in that community, they will be saved as well. Do the work of an evangelist. Make full proof of thy ministry. We're looking at 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 3. Looking at the ministry of this Timothy. He wasn't an idle person, and yet Paul the apostle said, Timothy, you know what? I need you in another place. I need you in Thessalonica so that you'll go to strengthen the faith of the people, establish them and comfort them. 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 3. As I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus, when I went into Macedonia, that thou mightest charge some that they teach no other doctrine. That was Timothy, and this Timothy was doing the work of God, just like Paul the apostle. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 16. We're looking at verse 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 10. Now, if Timotheus come, see that he may be with you without fear, for he, Timothy, walketh the work of the Lord as I also do. You see the confidence that this Paul the apostle had in this young man, Timothy. And you must be a person like that, that we have confidence in, for us to be able to send you out. There's sometimes some people, they say, hey, Pastor, I've been in the church for so many years now, and you know, I want to be a missionary, I want to be a pastor, I want to be this and that. That's a good desire. For a person to desire the office of a bishop, that's a good thing. But there are qualifications, and you can see this in the life and the ministry of Timothy. He made himself capable and qualified, and therefore was commanded and commissioned. And when the apostle said, go here, immediately he rose and he went. He wasn't dilly-dallying, he wasn't delaying, he wasn't dragging his feet. He wasn't saying, I'm going to drag my feet, I'll wait a little, so that the members of the church, they'll go and talk to the pastor and say, hey, pastor, what are you doing? Are you going to send Timothy out? Don't you know that you need Timothy with you in Athens? Are you going to send a person like this out? And you know, there are some people, when the Lord calls them through the pastor, through their leader, and he says, this is the place to go, they'll be dragging their feet, they'll be waiting, they'll be picking this and dropping it, and picking this and dropping it. All they're doing is, they're trying to, you know, buy time, and they're trying to wait, you know, 1 week, and 1 month, and 3 months are there, and they have not gone, and you're saying, what are you doing? I'm still preparing. The thing that, you know, sometimes members of the church will come to talk to the pastor and say, Pastor, why don't you leave this person alone? Because we need him here, we need him here, we need him here. And find another person who is useless. Find another person who is worthless, who cannot do anything good at the headquarters. Those are the people you have to send out. But Paul the apostle said, no, this is the person, capable person, committed person, competent person. A person that has the Spirit of God upon him and is doing the work of God as well as I am doing it, that's the person to send out. And thank God, Timothy did not waste time. You will not waste time. Let me come back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, what was he to do when he got there? Look at the latter part of verse 2. Chapter 3, verse 2. It says to establish you and to comfort you concerning your faith. To establish you and to comfort you concerning your faith. That's what we are to do. How do we do that? Acts of the Apostles chapter 16. Acts of the Apostles chapter 16. I'm reading there from verse 4 and verse 5. How do you establish the new converts? How do you establish a new church? How do you establish a new missionary field where you have just been sent? Acts of the Apostles chapter 16, verses 4 and 5. And as they went through the cities, they delivered them the decrees for to keep that were ordained of the apostles and elders which were at Jerusalem. Jerusalem was the headquarters church. And then the doctrine coming out of the headquarters, the lifestyle coming out of the headquarters, the process and the manner of worship coming out of the headquarters, and all the whole administration of the church coming out of the headquarters from Jerusalem, he delivered unto these people. Look at the result in verse 5. And so were the churches established in the faith and increased in number daily. That's what the Lord wants us to do, so that we are now establishing the people, not with strange doctrine, but with the doctrines of the Word of God. Hebrews chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 8 and verse 9. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8 and verse 9. Jesus Christ the same yesterday and today and forever. When we sent Timothy out, and they are to establish the churches, and they are to establish the mission field, they are to establish the places where they have gone. They are not people that will say, well, all this old doctrine of repentance, of salvation, of sanctification, Holy Ghost baptism, speaking in tongues, and one man, one wife, the whole thing that we're repeating every time. And they want to bring a new ideology, a new philosophy, a new doctrine, a strange doctrine. It says no, that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Then in verse 9, it says, be not carried about with divers and strange doctrines, for it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace. Established with grace, not with meats which have not profited them that have been occupied therein. Come back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. We're looking at that latter part of verse 2. It says, to establish you and to comfort you. And to comfort you. That was the second thing that Timothy was to do when he got to Thessalonica. Why? Because a lot of things were happening in Thessalonica. To start with, some people had died in Thessalonica. And then not only that, they were facing persecution. Not only that, there was the pressure of the Jewish people, Jewish religion upon them. And there were, some of them were getting confused, some of them were getting under pressure, some of them were being, the persecution was draining them out. And this, Timothy was to comfort them. Look at it now in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 18. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Words concerning the rapture, words concerning the second coming of the Lord, words concerning the protection, the preservation of the people of God, they were to be comforted. And that is the word that comforts us. And Timothy was to take that word unto them. 1 Corinthians chapter 14. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and I'm reading there from verse 31. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 31. How are they to be comforted? It says, for ye may all prophesy, proclaim, preach, declare the word, the will of the Lord, one by one, that all may learn and all may be comforted. What they learned will bring comfort unto them, the comfort of the word, the comfort of the scriptures. As Timothy got there, he will look at their situation. And as he looked at their situation, he will bring the word of God unto them. He'll say, hey, don't worry about that. It happened to so and so in Bible days like that. It happened to such and such in Bible days like that. And they came out of it. And with the word, he'll bring comfort unto them. Romans chapter 15, verse 4. Romans chapter 15, we're looking at verse 4. For whatsoever things were written aforetime, they were written for our learning, that through the patience and comfort of the scriptures, might have hope. Timothy was to go to Thessalonica, and when he got there, he was to bring the scriptures unto them, and through that scripture, they'll have hope and be comforted. We're coming to point number 2 now, persecuted fellowship of teachable purified saints. The persecuted fellowship of teachable persecuted saints. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, I'm reading from verses 3 and 4, that no man should be moved by these afflictions, for yourselves know that we are appointed thereunto. And what Paul the apostle was telling them is, it's very easy for somebody to get discouraged, for somebody to be moved. What is being moved? That is, when you are being in a position, for example, and then the wind is blowing and the storm is raging, and you allow the wind to blow you down and then to move you away from where you are, then you go to another place. You are in the position of, you are in the place and position of a believer. Persecution comes, storm comes, and all the storm raging moves you from being a believer to being a backslider. And Paul the apostle, I'm concerned that you are being a believer when I knew you, and the things that are happening, I don't want those afflictions to move you from the place, the position of a believer to that of a backslider. Look at that verse 3 again, that no man should be moved by these afflictions, for yourselves know that we are appointed thereunto. In verse 4, for verily when we were with you, we told you before that we should suffer tribulation, even as it came to pass, and ye know. Well, he told them. Why did he tell them? Because Jesus Christ told his own disciples. Every pastor is to tell all the people, and every leader of the church is to tell all the followers, that when you come to the Lord Jesus Christ, persecutions will definitely arise. And when you are told that, keep that in your heart, so that when it comes, it will not surprise you. When it comes, it will not jolt you. When it comes, it will not blow you down and move you and get you discouraged. The Lord said, I told you before persecution is coming, and when it comes, that's what the Lord spoke about. That's what the Holy Spirit has been reminding us, that persecution is coming. Now it has come. And it is not necessary for you to be moved just because there's persecution. Look at John chapter 15. John chapter 15, reading from verse 18. If the world hates you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. If ye were of the world will love his own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. That's the reason the persecution is coming, and you are not going to allow that to move you. It will not move you in Jesus' name. But that persecution will strengthen your spiritual muscle, and you'll go stronger and stronger every day in Jesus' name. But looking at the reason, why were they persecuted? Jesus said, you have been persecuted because I've chosen you out of the world. Because you are not of the world. Because you are not part of them. You know, that's why they persecute you. They're stealing. You don't want to steal office materials with them. They will persecute. They're changing the receipts and they're giving out wrong receipts. Because you are not of the world, you are not of them, they will persecute you. They're committing immorality, and then they're trying to push a spoiled lady on you. They have spoiled her already here and there. They are pushing that to you. They say, marry this one. And say, no, I'm sorry, I don't want to marry a non-believer. They'll persecute you because you don't want to join them in their evil. Or it is that they're trying to get into a covenant of evil. And then they say, hey, come on, join this, because everybody is there already. Pay your deal and come and register and be part of it. Say, no, I'm not of the world. I'm not of that kind of thing. Because you are not joining them, that's why they are going to persecute you. You are walking in a place and they are conspiring. And they conspire together, we're going to do evil. We're going to destroy this corporation. And we're going to tear everything down. And they say, come on, we're meeting. A meeting of conspiracy. I say, no, I'm a Christian. I'm not supposed to throw down or to destroy. I'm to build up. Because you're not joining them, they will persecute you. And then the Lord is saying, when it comes, know the reason why you're suffering persecution. And take your stand. And you will stand. I said you will stand. You know, there are people, they chicken out. They don't have any backbone. And when evil doers persecute them, and the only reason they are persecuting you is because you don't want to do evil with them. When you commit the evil with them, they are happy with you. Then you are of the world, you are not of Christ. But when you remember, I am of Christ, I'm not going to do the things they did. Come out from among them. I mean, you separate, says the Lord. When the persecution comes, that persecution, you rejoice in that persecution. I thought you'd say good amen. Amen. Matthew chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 10. It says, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake. If you know anything about a Christian is somebody who takes an uncompromising stand against sin. That's righteousness. And when you're persecuted for righteousness' sake, all they're saying is, hey, don't do that again. Don't stand for righteousness. Compromise. Bend. Yield. Surrender. Surrender your soul. Surrender the doctrine. Surrender the righteousness. And then when you take your stand, they'll persecute you. When it comes, you will stand. It says, blessed are they which are persecuted. For what sake? For righteousness. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you, persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. That's why they persecute, but you are going to stand. Matthew chapter 10, verse 22. Matthew chapter 10, verse 22. And you shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, because you are holding on to the name of the Lord and the doctrine of the Lord and the righteousness that come through the name of the Lord. It says the name of the Lord is like a mighty tower, and the righteous runneth into it and is saved. Because you are holding on to that name and the righteousness of the Lord, that's why they persecute. But it says that you will not be afraid of that. Ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved. When you endure in that righteousness, remain in that righteousness, abide in that righteousness, and you don't allow the persecution, the jesting, the joking, and the insult and the assault to move you, and say righteousness is the way to heaven, holiness is the way to heaven, purity of heart and life is the way to heaven, and that is the way to stand. And you stand in it, that is when you are going to endure, and you endure to the very end. 2 Timothy chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 10. 2 Timothy chapter 3, we're looking at it from verse 10. It says in verse 10, but thou hast fully known my doctrine, my manner of life, my purpose, my faith, my long-suffering, my charity, my patience, my persecutions, my affliction, which came unto me at Antioch and at Iconium and at Lystra. What persecutions I endured, but out of them all, tell me the rest. The Lord delivered me. The Lord will deliver you. You know, when persecution comes, the Lord is right there, and his rod and his staff, they comfort me. And the Lord will not leave me alone in that persecution in Jesus' name. It will increase your faith. It will increase the grace of God in your life. It will give you stamina. It will give you strength. And you'll be able to stand. As the persecutors increase and persecution increase, then the Lord will increase his power, protection, preservation in your life in Jesus' name. And then we're told in verse 12, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution, but evil men and sedition shall wax worse and worse. Don't let that disturb you. As evil men are waxing worse and worse, the Lord will be greater and stronger in your life, and your faith and your dependence upon the Lord will be stronger and greater in Jesus' name. Evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. You see what the Lord is saying. He says, don't allow persecution to stop you. Don't allow persecution to derail you. Don't allow persecution to stop you halfway. You continue to the very end in spite of all that persecution. In fact, the Lord is saying that when that persecution comes, you're going to rejoice. Look at John chapter 16, verse 33. John chapter 16, verse 33. These things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation. He told us, in the world ye shall have tribulation. That's talking about the temptation, about the trial, about the persecution, about all the troubles that will come. In the world ye shall have tribulation. You know, sometimes the people you think will never persecute you, they are the people that will persecute. Because if somebody is not born again, it's going to persecute those who are born again. And if somebody does not have the Spirit of God, it's going to persecute those who have the Spirit of God. If somebody does not have a stand, uncompromising stand, righteousness, is going to persecute those who are having a stand, a real uncompromising stand. It doesn't matter, they might love you yesterday and smile at you yesterday and fellowship with you yesterday. It doesn't matter if they don't have any stand, uncompromising stand, if they don't have principle. When you stand for principle, even though they were rejoicing with you yesterday, today, when you are standing for something that they don't want to stand for, they're going to persecute you. But that will not move you in Jesus' name. That's why Jesus said, in the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And because you overcame, you are going to overcome as well. In fact, it says we are appointed unto it. If we are appointed unto it, we are not going to allow anything to bother us or to derail us. We're looking at Romans chapter 8, reading from verse 35. Romans chapter 8, verse 35. It says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? I'm going to direct it at you now. Are you ready? I said, are you ready? Who shall separate you from the love of Christ? Anybody? Shall tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, burial, or sword? As it is written, for your sake, for thy sake, we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, you are more than a conqueror. Through him that loved you. I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, neither height, nor death, nor any other creature shall be able to separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus your Lord. The Lord will preserve you in Jesus' name. The persecution may come in many ways. You know, it comes sometimes through hatred and bitter rejection. Sometimes it is slander and false accusation. Sometimes the persecution is scourging and beating, or mocking, or insult, or assault. Sometimes reproaches and laws. Sometimes it's dishonor and evil report. They tell some big lies against you, something unimaginable, that even when you were a sinner, there's no way you could have done that, even as a sinner. Not to talk of now you're a believer, you are saved and sanctified, real child of God. And then they said, we're going to spread bad rumor, terrible rumor against his life. And then it goes from person to person, and then as rumor is going around, it's increasing. And then it comes back to you and they say, hey, they said you did this, you said me. And then the devil wants to say, since they say you are a sinner, go and sin now. Since they say you are a backslider, if you are suffering for what you've not done, and everybody is saying, look at him, he's a witch, look at him, he's a sinner, look at him, he's a thief, look at him, he's this and that. Slander, terrible, terrible things they say. Don't allow that to move you. Keep on following the Lord, and one of these days, the Lord will vindicate you in Jesus' name. Sometimes it's betrayal by false brethren. The people who appear to be friends and brothers and sisters, and they are hovering around you as if they love you, are smiling every time they see, and yet in the back, they're conspiring against you, wanting to bring you down, and wanting to destroy you, and wanting to throw a dagger at your heart spiritually. You know, betrayal will be there by those people that are backsliders and not standing, and they'll be thinking they are standing, but you take your stand. Sometimes it's public ridicule, isolation, or excommunication. Sometimes it's suffering, even martyrdom. But our Lord Jesus Christ has warned us, as he warned the disciples, to expect that there will be persecution. The world will not love believers. The world will not appreciate believers. What to expect? The persecution will come from those who hated and killed and not Jesus Christ. Paul had faithfully taught the believers in Thessalonica and everywhere too, that for verily he said, when we were with you, we told you before that ye should suffer tribulation, persecution, even as it came to pass, and ye know. The Thessalonians proved the reality of their conversion and the genuineness of their faith by remaining steadfast and committed during persecution. You too, your worst time. Look at Galatians. I'm looking at Galatians now. We're looking at chapter 4, verse 29. Galatians chapter 4, verse 29. Galatians chapter 4. We're reading from verse 29, so that when these things happen, you will know that, you know, it's happening that way because of who they are and because of who you are. Galatians chapter 4, verse 29. But as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now. The carnal will persecute the spiritual. The sinner will persecute the saint. The backslider will persecute the believer. It's always been like that. The unrighteous will persecute the righteous. It's always like that. The one that doesn't believe the totality of the Bible will persecute the person that is believing the Bible. The one that is not holding any doctrine, he's just a wishy-washy churchgoer, doesn't hold any doctrine, and doesn't know where he stands. doesn't know the left from the right. He'll persecute the people that are holding firmly unto the word of God. As it was then, so it is now. And when it happens like that, just say, Lord, forgive them, they're just carnal. Lord, forgive them, they're just sinful. Lord, forgive them, they're just backsliders. And because I'm standing a thing, they're going to make me like them by the persecution, but they will not succeed. I said they will not succeed. We'll keep on standing on the truth, this eternal truth, earnestly contending for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints until the final day in Jesus' name. We'll come to point number three now. Paternal feeling, pastoral feeling, parental feeling for tempted, persecuted sons. I'm coming back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, and we're reading there from verse 5. Paul the apostle had been talking to these believers and had been assuring them. He said, I love you. I even wanted to come to you myself, but Satan has hindered my personal visitation unto you. Because of that, I'm sending Timothy unto you, and Timothy will do what I would have done. Look at verse 5 now. For this cause, when I could no longer forbear, you know, the devil had been whispering in the ears of those Thessalonians, Paul the apostle, he doesn't love you. He came over here, preached a rousing message, a wonderful message, and you all just gave your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now you are suffering persecution. He doesn't even remember you, and he's, you know, jumped to other places, and he's gone to other places, and he doesn't care whether you live or you die. He doesn't care whether you're standing or you're falling. He doesn't care whether you're happy or you are sad. He doesn't care whether you're making progress, you are going back. That's a lie that the people were telling the Thessalonians. They say, where is Paul now? Where is Paul now? He's nowhere to be found. He's gone to other places. He's in Athens, he's in Corinth, he's over here, he's over here, and he will never come back here to you. And he doesn't have your heart. That's why he told them, look at chapter 1 again. Let me remind you. Look at chapter 1. He said, we give thanks to God always in verse 2 for you all, making mention of you in our prayers. Don't allow anybody to tell you that I, Paul, I'm not thinking about you because I've not come to you. I wanted to come to you. I wanted to do it myself. Even though I could not come, I've been praying for you, making mention of you in my prayers. Look at verse 3, remembering without ceasing your work of faith and your labor of love and your patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. He told them that he's been remembering them every time. He said, I don't wake up any day without praying for you, without thinking about you. And then come to chapter 2 now. In chapter 2, he said, in verse 17, for we brethren be taken from you for a short time in the presence, not in heart. He said, don't allow what they are telling you. Out of mind is out of sight. Does he remember you? He's too busy to remember you. Don't allow that. And that's the lie somebody will tell you sometimes. You know, the pastor is not concerned about this section, about that section, and then you get discouraged. But that's not true. He says, we're taken away from you in presence, but not in heart. Endeavor the more abundantly to see your face with great desire. He was encouraging them that he'll never forget them. That's why he told them in verse 18, wherefore we would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us. Then he said in verse 19, for what is our hope or joy or even crown of rejoicing? Are not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ that is coming? For ye are our glory and joy. He said, well, you're not important to Paul. He has so many converts in all the other places. Thessalonica, you think that Paul is thinking about you? He said, don't mind those people. He was reminding them that all the lies the enemies were telling them, those lies were not true. And thank God, all the lies the enemies are telling you, the lies are not true. You know that God loves you, and the Father is thinking about you. Jesus Christ is praying for you, interceding for you, for all your needs. And the Lord Jesus Christ will meet your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Give me a good amen. Amen. And of course, I'm thinking about you as your pastor, as your father in the Lord. And every good thing that you need, the Lord will supply in Jesus' name. And he's going to perfect everything concerning you. That you see my face or don't see my face, that doesn't matter. That doesn't mean it's not just because I come to your district or come to your state or come to your region. Whether I'm there or not, you are in my mind, and the Lord will do everything he ought to do in your life in Jesus' name. Amen. That's why he said in verse 5, for this cause, when I could no longer forbear, I wanted to come and I could not come. Therefore, I sent to know your faith, lest by some means the tempter, by all those lies, have tempted you, and our labor be in vain. The labor of the people of God concerning you will not be in vain. Let's look at what these tempters, what they do. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. And I'm reading there from verse 2. 2 Corinthians 11, verse 2. For I am jealous over you with godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. Paul the Apostle said, that's my concern, that's my heart. I want to present you as a pure virgin, a holy virgin, a sanctified virgin, an undefiled virgin unto the Lord Jesus Christ, your husband or your bridegroom. For I fear lest by any means that the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your minds should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. Paul the Apostle said, I'm always concerned that you will not lose the simplicity of the gospel, the sincerity of the gospel, the security in the gospel, and the totality of the gospel, so that the enemy will not seduce you, so that the enemy will not entice you to go into anything false. How did he do that? Look at verse 11. Look at verse 13. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. You know what the devil does? He sent the false apostles, and they come with false testimonies, and they say, well, look at the problem you have. Have you been able to see your coordinator? No. Have you been able to see your group coordinator? No. How about the state overseer? No. How about your general superintendent? No. Well, look at what is happening over here. Just around the corner here, there's another fellowship there, and that man is a great man of God. In fact, we even call him apostle, and he can do this and do this for you. And he says they are false apostles and deceitful workers, transforming themselves to be the apostle of Christ. And then sometimes they'll bring, you know, such the scripture of deeper life out and say, see, we're even using the same material, and we have all the time for you. And if they don't have time for you to be able to, we are here. In fact, we're using the same material, and we're preaching the same message as well. It says they are deceitful workers. They transform themselves to be the apostles of light. They will not catch you. They will not deceive you in Jesus' name. In verse 14, it says, and no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great sin if his ministers, they are ministers of Satan, but they also transform themselves as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. But Paul the Apostle, again, he wanted to emphasize that he was concerned about the believers, because the lies they were telling all those people is that, you know, the pastor is not concerned about you. All he's concerned about is doctrine. All he's concerned about is evangelism. All he's concerned about is missionary work, going from here to there. He is not concerned about you. That's why he said in verse 28, look at verse 28, he said, but those things that are without, then he said, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. He says, I'm thinking about all the churches, the church in Corinth and the church of Galatians and the church in Thessalonica. Then he says, who is weak and I'm not weak? He said, when people are weak or they're weakened by the circumstances upon themselves, it touches me, it reaches my heart, and I'm weak as well. Who is offended and I burn not? And so you understand what he was saying. He said they were in his heart, and you are in the heart of the leaders as well, in Jesus' name. You are precious to God, you are precious to the church, and you are precious to us as well. And I pray that you will not lose the value we place on you, in Jesus' name. In Galatians chapter 4, verse 11, Galatians chapter 4, verse 11, I am afraid of you, lest I bestowed upon you labor in vain. And that's like a mother talking to the child, because the mother had gone through the labor pain to deliver that child. And then just because the mother went to the market, or the mother traveled out to, you know, the village and to come back a few days after, or the mother went overseas because of maybe some important assignment, and then a woman in the neighborhood will come to that child and say, "Where is mommy?" "Well, mommy is not at home." And that's what I'm telling you. You know, get this biscuit and get this sweet and get this. And then he's trying to tell that child, you know, that I love you more than your mommy. Hey, understand, biscuit is not of so much value. And the things they're giving you, that temporary, they're not of so much value that you will say that, you know, that woman loves you more than your mother. That's the mother that had the labor pains. That's the mother that, you know, cared for you when your baby, changed all the diapers and took care of you when you were crying. That's the mother that took care of you when you were sick. And just one day woman that came to give biscuit or sweet, that doesn't make that woman greater than your mother. That's what Paul the apostle was saying. He said, "I'm afraid of you, lest I bestowed labor upon you in vain. Brethren, I beseech you, be as I am, for I am as ye am. Ye have not injured me at all. Ye know how through the infirmity of the flesh I preached the gospel unto you at the first." He said, "When I was sick, I didn't say I was sick, I kept on preaching. And when I was weak, I didn't say I was weak, I kept on preaching. When they stoned me and they left me for dead, I got up, I kept on preaching. And when some things happened to me that some in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, blow me over and over, I never stopped preaching. And I did that because I love you." And some people are coming to you now to say, "Paul doesn't love you, he's not caring." He said, "Don't listen to them. Through the infirmity of the flesh, I preach the gospel unto you and the false. And my temptation, my own trial, which was in my flesh, ye despised not, nor rejected, but you received me as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus." He said, "Where then is the blessedness you speak of? Because when I was doing that, and you got saved, you got sanctified, you were healed, you were delivered, you were blessed, and then God gave you a wife, God gave you a husband, God gave you children, God did a lot for you through my ministry," he said, "you were happy." Then he said, "Where is the blessedness now that you speak of? That if it had been possible, you would have plucked out your own eyes and would have given them to me. Am I might therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth?" You know, Paul the apostle became concerned. He said, "Galatians, what's happening to you? Who are the people deceiving you to say that your pastor, your leader, the apostle, is no more interested in you?" He said, "They zealously affect you, but not well. Yea, they would exclude you that ye might affect them." They want to cut you off from the very root and from the foundation of what you have got. And I pray that will not happen to you. That's why he said, but it's a good thing to be seriously affected, always a good thing. And then he says, not only when I am present with you, my little children, I'm concerned over you, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you. I desire to be present with you now and to change my voice, for I stand in doubt of you. I pray we'll not stand in doubt of you. You'll keep on standing firmly until the very end in Jesus' name. And that's the feeling Paul the apostle had for these Thessalonian believers. I'm concerned about you, I'm concerned about you. He repeatedly told them. And that's the same thing we're telling the church, that our leaders are concerned over the members. Our leaders, coordinators, group coordinators, state overseers, pastors, and local government everywhere, we're concerned over you. You are going to stand. And we'll all get to heaven together in Jesus' name. Coming to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, we're looking at verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Look unto Jesus. Any trial, any tribulation, any challenge, any sickness, anything that is oppressing your life. It says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. And don't you forget what the Lord has taught us all these years in verse 14, for do peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. That's what they want to get away from you. They want to uproot you from your foundation. They want to dissuade you, get you away from your conviction. They want to say, hey, those people, the preachers, holiness, all the preachers, you know, purity and sanctification. How about healing? We're sick, they are talking about holiness. How about getting married? We don't have any wife, they're talking about holiness. How about getting husband? How about all these years we have married and there's no child yet? I want to see them all in holiness, holiness. What are we going to eat, holiness, when there's no child? They try to discourage you and they say, you know, prosperity, you don't have your own house, you don't have this, you don't have that, no education, no progress. They're talking about holiness. Don't mind them. Well, they are the people you will not mind. I said they are the people you will not mind. And I want to tell you, all those people that try to discourage you and dissuade you and uproot you from your foundation, I say, don't mind them. Say, I will not mind them. You will stand in the truth. And everything that you need, the Lord will supply in Jesus' name. Whether I see you face to face, physically or not, it doesn't matter. I'm praying for you and all the needs in your life, the Lord will supply in Jesus' name. We're looking at Philippians chapter 4, Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. But my God shall supply all your need. I said, my God shall supply all your need. Whether you're in Corinth, you're in Athens, you're in Thessalonica, wherever you are, and even though we have not come to see you, I'm thinking about you, I'm praying for you. And you know, God hears prayer at a distance. You know, somebody can be in Lagos and pray for somebody else, and somebody over there in Port Harcourt or in Benin City or in Kaduna, or in Jos or Kebbi or anywhere we are, as I pray here, God will answer the prayer. Yeah. You know, I remember that, you know, we're having a program in Sokoto, and you know, Sokoto is so far away up north. And then, you know, I was after the meeting that day. In fact, that day, I just went to Sokoto because, you know, the people were telling them, Pastor Kumu, he will never come. He'll never come. That this place is too small for him to come. And I wanted to just assure the people that I'm for everyone. And I just traveled there just to say, hello, how are you there? And then they decided that we'll still have an evening meeting there. And I told them, I was just giving them just a little thing that I'll still come back. And the promise is still there. And then that night we were praying in Sokoto. And as I was praying, there was somebody in a Delta state all the way down south. And that fellow, you know, one eye at me, it was a child of 16 years of age. And that child, a security man at the gate of the school, used the whip accidentally and knocked up the eye, and the eye was totally blind. They took that child to many hospitals, and there was nothing they could do. The eye was gone. And then in Sokoto, I said, now we're going to pray. And this brother in Sokoto State there in the city, he phoned the young man in a Delta, and he said, we're praying now. Put on your phone, put it in your ear. And as I said, in Jesus' name, in Sokoto, then in Delta, that eye got opened. That's why I'm telling you that distance does not matter. The distance between you and I will not stop the prayer. Look at Psalm 138. Psalm 138, I'm reading there from verse 8. Psalm 138, we're looking at verse 8. In Psalm 138, over there in verse 8, the Lord will perfect everything which concerneth you. His mercy, O Lord, will endure forever. He will not forsake you because of the work of his own hand. Rise up and let us talk to the Lord. The Lord remembers you. Don't allow any discouragement. Don't allow anybody to tell you that, you know, God doesn't remember. Jesus doesn't remember. The leaders don't remember. The pastor doesn't remember. You're in our heart. We'll remember you. The Lord remembers you. Everything concerning you, the Lord will perfect. And the Lord is going to supply your need. Just tell the Lord, what's bothering you in your heart? The persecution, the pain, the difficulty, the challenge that you are having. What's the problem? What are you thinking of going back? What are you thinking of backsliding? What are you thinking of separating yourself from the church, not going to the house fellowship, and not going to the local church, not going to the district church, not going to the zone anymore, and then you're avoiding everybody? They don't love me. They don't love me. Of course, we love you. How could they? How could Satan tell you that? Of course, we love you. We're thinking about you. We're praying for you. You are in our heart every time. And if we're not able to come, we'll send a Timothy there. We'll send a Silas there. We'll send a Titus there. We'll send an Epaphroditus there. We'll send somebody there. Epaphras will be there. And whatever they say, that's what we're saying. What I should have said is what your leaders are saying. The prayer you should have prayed is what your leaders are praying. And everything the world should have counseled you the way they are counseling you. And the Lord, through their counseling, I'll counsel my journey heart and hand with them. The Lord will perfect everything concerning you. Don't worry about what the devil may say. Don't worry about what the devil may do. You will overcome. To those who are impure, there's a power. To those who are weak, to those who are powerless, supplier to those who are in need. His promises are yours. Accept, believe, receive, and it's yours in Jesus' name. I said it's yours in Jesus' name. You'll never lack.
Amen.
You'll not suffer hunger.
Amen.
Your weakness, the Lord will strengthen you.
Amen.
The power of the Lord will hold you up in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Your enemies will not rejoice over you.
Amen.
Those who want you dead will regret.
Amen.
You remain alive and outlive them in Jesus' name. The power of the Lord will sustain you. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you today. We bless your name because we know you're all things to all your people. And I pray for everyone, your saving grace will come to every life in Jesus' name. And for those who are leaving their sins behind, they're taking you, Jesus, as their Lord and Savior, I pray all their sins you forgive in Jesus' name. And the joy of salvation, the victory of salvation, the power that sustains those who are saved, let it come to those people as they are holding on to your saving grace right now in Jesus' name. Any sickness, any infirmity, any weakness, Lord, I speak your word to that sickness and I command that sick person be healed in Jesus' name. All the oppression, all the attack, all the things the devil is throwing at the people of God, I break every yoke. I destroy the works of the devil. Set your people free in Jesus' name. Total deliverance, total freedom, total liberty. Give unto your people in Jesus' name. Come out of your depression and come out of that evil pain upon your life in Jesus' name. Deliverance is yours. Dominion is yours. Victory is yours. You are more than a conqueror in Jesus' name. Whatever need in your life, in your profession, whatever need in your life, in your family, whatever need in your life, anywhere you are, I pray that right now this God of heaven, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, will supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Your tears are wiped away. Your sorrow is taken away. All the needs in your life are supplied. God has given you a definite miracle you'll never forget. You go back home rejoicing. Your joy, your victory, your salvation, your holiness, your purity, nobody will ever take away. You go from strength to strength and power to power. And on the final day when the Lord shall come, you'll be among the saints that go marching. Lord, confirm it in every life. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.